I hope everyone enjoyed their coffee or tea, respectively, in Gather Town. And I hear some serious synchronization action was going on. In light of that, you must be very well socially bonded to join this incredible lecture that we're about to encounter by Ani Patel from Tufts University, where he's a professor in psychology. And it's a particular place for me because it's my alma mater. And certainly the place that I first met Ani. How many years ago? I don't want to count, but
been a while.
Highly appreciative of always nudging us ahead with your philosophical thoughts on the topics of high interest to us. And I can't wait to hear you elaborate on today's topic, musical beat processing and gene culture coevolution, Ani. Take the floor, please.
Thank you so much, Sonia. It's so nice to be here with everybody. I wish I could have attended every single talk at this conference, but due to the start of teaching at my university this week, that was not possible. So I'll be watching all the videos with great interest. But today I'm going to talk about taking an evolutionary approach to the question of music and human nature. So as we all know, music is a human universal present in every culture, and of course, very ancient based on the archaeological record, and also very powerful in terms of the access it has to our emotion systems, our memory systems, our movement systems, its power in social rituals, and so on. Of course, it has large cultural diversity in structure and in meaning, and that's hugely important. And I've been fascinated by the diversity of music, the way it's made and what it means to people for a long time. I was brought into that kind of education in ethnomusicology through a wonderful ethnomusicologist, Kay Kaufman Chalamet, who was a professor at Harvard when I was in grad school. And it's been a really rich part of being in this field. And she just came out with a new book, actually, about musicians as kind of cultural sentinels of, who carry the culture, especially during times of diaspora and spreading of communities. Her book is Sing and Sing On, just came out, which I highly recommend. So there's great diversity and structure in music around the world, which is really important. But there are some widespread features in music around the world, such as, for example, melodies made from discrete pitches and intervals, repetitive rhythmic patterns and an underlying beat, and strong links to rhythmic movement and dance, and a simultaneous coordinated sound production. And all of these are unlike ordinary speech. So for example, in speech, we take turns, we don't talk simultaneously. So how old is human music? I said it was ancient, and this is a little map I've helped myself kind of get an intuitive sense of how old it is. This is the bone flute I showed you before, and this is a little cartoonish map of some periods in human history and some civilizations you may recognize, the Roman Empire, the Greeks, the Minoans, the dynastic Egyptians, and there's a timeline at the bottom. And the flute is not on this map. And so if we extend it back, we can go back to the Stone Age, where cities began and agriculture began around 10,000 years ago. You can see writing beginning around 3000 BC. But the flute is still not on this map. And to get the flute to appear, we have to make that entire period of history that size and then extend our timeline back and back and back until we get to the flute. And so this is 40,000 years ago. This is a time when humans shared the planet with Neanderthals. Woolly mammoths would not go extinct for another 20,000 years. And of course, this is very unlikely to be the oldest music because there's plenty of small-scale cultures that sing but don't have musical instruments today. And so music singing doesn't fossilize, so it's very likely music is much more ancient than the oldest ancient instruments. So it's been around for a very, very long time, and it's in every human culture. So are we an inherently musical species from a biological perspective? Well, is it one of the things we evolved to do? Well, brain imaging shows that human brains have neural populations specialized for music perception, even in non-musicians, as has been shown very nicely in a recent paper from Josh McDermott's lab at MIT. This is from the thesis work of Dana Bobinger. Here's a picture of a brain with the colored areas showing regions where neurons and neural populations respond more strongly to music than to any other kind of sound. And that's interesting because it's not like they're neurons that respond to every familiar category. There aren't neurons that respond more strongly when you hear traffic as opposed to anything else, or dogs barking as opposed to anything else. So far, it seems to be only speech and music that have this kind of category selective response. in the brain. Does this show that we are inherently musical? Well, as interesting as it is, no, it doesn't, because in literate individuals, there are neural populations specialized for recognizing written text. For example, the visual word form area shown in this cartoonish diagram of the brain, in this little red area here, it's an area that's involved in interpreting visual shapes as written characters in your native language, and it connects to the brain's language network. And literacy is a purely cultural invention. We actually know the history of literacy because of archaeology. It's about 5,000 years old. We know when it was invented and how it spread. And so it's definitely not something we evolved to do. It's something we invented based on other skills that we have, like language and visual control and motor control and so forth, visual processing and motor control. So brains can develop specialized processing for cultural inventions within individual lifetimes via experience-dependent neuroplasticity. And this relates to the neural recycling theory of Dehane and Cohen. Bits of the brain can get reused that they evolved perhaps to serve other functions, then culture can redeploy them for new invented capacities. So we're not an inherently literate species, even though literacy has great value to human societies. Our brains didn't evolve to read and write. We invented that technology and our brains can adapt to it within our lifetime. And so asking if we're inherently musical is not a question about the value of music, because literacy is hugely valuable, but we didn't evolve to read and write. So questions of value and of whether or not we evolved to do something are separate questions. So we can reframe, are we an inherently musical species, as a neuroscience question. And you can ask, have we evolved any neural specializations for music processing? Or is music purely a cultural invention, kind of neurally recycling brain functions that evolved for other reasons, like literacy does? And actually, there's no consensus on the answer to this question. And that's interesting because there's been an explosion of research on music in the brain since about 2000. And this is a question about music in the brain. Have we evolved neural specializations for music processing? And despite all the magnificent work on music in the brain, there's no agreement whether we evolved to be musical. And my own position on this has changed. So as a grad student, I was pretty sure the answer to this question was yes, we have evolved neural specializations for music processing. After studying music in the brain for 12 more years, and in my book, Music Language of the Brain, I said, no, I don't think we have evidence that we've evolved neural specializations for music processing. And now it's been 25 years since my PhD, and I'm back to thinking, maybe yes, we have evolved neural specializations for music processing. So give me another 15 years and I'll probably be back to know, but I'm a yes right now and I'm excited about it. And that's what I'm gonna talk about today. So why does this question matter? Well, it's an unsettled issue about human nature where there are very smart people on opposite sides of this question with very articulate ideas. And I think we can answer this question within a few decades. And also, if yes, musicality could help us explore a key process in human evolution, which is cognitive gene culture coevolution, I'll get into that more as we get further into the talk. So I've been using this term musicality, and so I want to spend a slide on that and this distinction between music and musicality. So music always refers to a specific musical tradition that's always deeply shaped by history and culture. So we can talk about German Baroque music or American jazz and so forth. But musicality in the biological sense are the cognitive abilities underlying very basic musical abilities. Those kinds of abilities that emerge without any formal training that are widely seen across the population. It doesn't mean special interest or talent in music. It has a different sense in the cognitive use of the term. And Henk-Jan Honing and his colleagues have been very helpful in helping clarify this difference between music and musicality. So a simple example of musicality is our ability to recognize a melody, whether it's played on a piccolo or a tuba. The same tune played high or low. You may have never heard it played that high or low before, but you recognize it immediately. And that's just part of music cognition that you don't have to learn. Infants seem to be able to do it. It seems to be something we just come with as a species. And so the analogy to musicality in language is music versus musicality is like the difference between specific languages and the capacities that support language. So phonological capacity, semantic capacity, syntactic abilities, and so forth. So there's broad consensus that some core linguistic capacities rely on neural adaptations, so that our brains have evolved over time to make language come naturally to us. So there are changes in our brain over time that support the sensory motor processing of speech. There are changes over evolutionary time that make it possible for us to easily cognitively process words, which is a hugely complex cognitive ability that seems effortless to us. And evidence comes from many lines of research, including developmental studies and neuroimaging, comparing species. So there's work by James Rilling and colleagues, for example, looking at long distance fiber tracks in the human brain and showing important differences in tracks known to be important in language, like the arcuate fasciculus, in the structure of that tract in a human versus, say, a chimpanzee and a macaque, and particularly how deeply it goes into the temporal lobe, probably important for accessing word meanings and so forth. All right, so have we evolved any neural specializations for music processing? Who thinks the answer is yes? Well, Darwin thought the answer was yes in his book on the human evolution, The Descent of Man, and he argued that wordless singing evolved before speech, laying the foundation for language evolution. And he hypothesized the original function of music behavior was attracting mates, a part of his theory of sexual selection. Now, there are many other adaptationist hypotheses proposed since Darwin's time, focusing on other possible benefits of music for our ancestors besides attracting mates. And just two really nice recent examples were published in Behavioral and Brain Sciences and papers that I'm sure you know by Pat Savage and colleagues and Sam Mayer and colleagues. These are multifaceted papers. They have many features, but one thing they do share is this emphasis on the significance of collective musical behavior for human evolution. Pat Savage and colleagues arguing that collective singing and dancing promoted social bonding, which had benefits for collective action outside of musical context. And Sam Mayer and colleagues arguing that collective rhythmic displays were kind of a credible signal of group strength or size or coordination. So they both tap into the idea that collective music has a kind of synchrony that doesn't occur in language and has powerful social effects. And there's interesting empirical research related to that. There's a review or a meta-analysis cited there. And two of the authors of that first paper, Pat Savage and Sek Liu, actually gave keynotes at this conference. Okay, so who thinks the answer to this question, on the other hand, is no? Who thinks that music is a pure cultural invention like literacy that nothing we particularly evolved to do, but happily we can do? Well, William James thought that in The Principles of Psychology. He didn't write much about music, but what he wrote there made it very clear that that's what he believed. That idea has been developed by later thinkers, including Daniel Sperber, the anthropologist, Steven Pinker, the psychologist. And the basic idea is that music uses brain circuits that evolve for other reasons. Circuits from language, from motor control, from emotion, from many different cognitive functions, and puts them together to make this magnificent cultural product. So this Darwin-James debate continues on. And if you want to get a flavor of that debate, you can look at the 60 commentaries that were published in response to the Savage and Mayer papers in Behavioral and Brain Sciences. And in thinking about this debate, it's really important to make a key conceptual distinction. It's broadly agreed that humans have neural adaptations for accurate social learning of arbitrary motor and cognitive skills. So for example, we're just good cultural learners. We can learn kind of all kinds of things, right? You can learn how to make a good canoe if you happen to be an Inuit living in the 1800s, and that's really an important life skill for hunting and finding food. But we didn't evolve to make canoes. It's just we evolved to be good social learners, and there's actually neuroscience evidence that parts of our brain are specialized for cultural learning. On the other hand, we also have neural adaptations for learning some specific sensory motor and cognitive skills like spoken language. And so the debate is really over which category musicality belongs in. Is it a reflection of our general ability to learn complicated and interesting things? Or is it something that our brain is specialized to learn in specific ways? Well, you might ask, how could music be a purely cultural invention if it's ancient and universal? Unlike writing, right? I mean, 40,000 year old flute versus roughly 5,000 year old writing. And of course, writing is far from universal. Well, some cultural inventions are ancient and universal. So the ability to make and control fire, which is universal in human culture, is thought to date back at least 400,000 years. And purely cultural inventions can spread and become universal because such inventions offer things of universal value to humans, like in the case of fire, warmth, protection, cooking, and so on. And in my book, I argue that music was analogous to fire in this respect, except that what music offered that was universally valued was mental rather than physical. So its emotional power, its framework for rituals, its efficacy for memory, for holding long sequences of information and memory before writing. And I refer to fire control and music as transformative technologies, so inventions that changed human culture in powerful ways, but nothing that we evolved to do. And I built on that idea in a chapter in 2010 called Music, Biological Evolution in the Brain. But I have an updated view now, driven by current research on musicality, the things that have happened since I published the book in that chapter in the last decade. Neural research, cross-species research, research done by people at this conference. And so it's been a very exciting time in the field for me. And the idea here is that musical behavior originated as a cultural invention based on things our brains could do. But then it spread culturally because it had efficacy for human ancestors. So one of the possible functions that were mentioned in those earlier adaptive papers. And that eventually led to some neural adaptations for musicality. So this is an example of what's called culture-driven genetic evolution. That is, once musical behavior was invented, genetic variants promoting musicality were favored. This is gene-culture coevolution, or GCC as a nickname. And GCC is a feedback loop between cultural invention and biological evolution. Things that are invented then have consequences for biology over evolutionary timescales. And this is actually an accepted mechanism for some aspects of human non-neural physiology. For example, the invention of dairying, of keeping animals that produce milk and drinking their milk, led to the evolution of lactose tolerance in some populations that had a history of doing that. That's a well-documented case of gene-culture coevolution in evolutionary biology. The control of fire is actually thought to be a good case of gene-culture coevolution because cooking changed the demands on our digestive system. It essentially made food a lot easier to digest, and that shaped our digestive system in important ways. Our digestive tracts got shorter, our jaws and teeth got smaller. Some people think it freed up energy to allowing us to evolve a larger brain. There's really interesting theories about that by Richard Wrangham and Rachel Carmody. So the idea that there could have been gene culture coevolution for musicality, that the invention of musical behavior had downstream consequences for our biology, is something I discussed in the 2018 chapter in the book Origins of Musicality. But other people have also brought up this idea, like Gary Tomlinson from the perspective of music. He's a musicologist. Pat Savage talks about this in his 2021 paper. So I'm not the first to suggest it or the only one. There are many voices from many different fields now, and I think it's that convergence is interesting. Ian Cross actually wrote about biocultural evolution back in 2003 for music. So, but what I'm doing is I'm trying to bring a cognitive neuroscience perspective to this idea. But then stepping back a minute, why would it matter? If musicality evolved via gene culture coevolution, why would that matter to larger thinking about human nature? Well, evolutionary biologists increasingly theorize that several key aspects of our minds, human minds, evolved via a process of gene culture coevolution, as opposed to the traditional means of random genetic variation and natural selection. So things like cooperation with non-kin, which humans are very unusual in the extent to which we cooperate with other members of our species that are totally unrelated to us, our language abilities, and our cognitive aspects of tool use. And so it's for some time now, evolutionary biologists have been writing about gene culture coevolution as a key shaping factor in the way our minds emerged and our special cognitive abilities emerged, going back to 81, Genes, Minds, and Culture by Lumsden and Wilson, Yablanka and Lamb's Evolution in Four Dimensions in 2005, Kevin Lawland's Darwin's Unfinished Symphony in 2018. So the idea is definitely out there in evolutionary biology, but strong evidence for cognitive gene culture coevolution for this process shaping our mind is really still lacking. And that's unlike for non-neural aspects of human physiology, like digestion, lactase tolerance, where strong evidence exists. So cognitive GCC remains an intriguing hypothesis at the moment without compelling evidence. And if we find a compelling evidence that musicality evolved this way, musicality could actually be a model system for studying cognitive GCC with lessons for other domains. So it could have broader relevance for human evolutionary biology, especially the evolution of the human mind. All right, so that brings us to the key question, right? Have we evolved any neural specializations for music processing? And then how do we even study that question? And to get into that, I want to introduce four key concepts. First, in the way that question is phrased, the word any is an important qualifier. Have we evolved any neural specializations? Now, obviously, many neural mechanisms used by music are not specialized for music. So when we listen to music, we do sound localization. And we do that when we listen to speech, and we do that when we listen to any sound. We can't help it. It's built in. A lot of it happens subcortically. Those mechanisms did not evolve to subserve music, nor it's very unlikely that any of them have become specialized for music. Music uses them just like any other aspects of hearing. So it's not that everything we do when we process music is specialized for music. The question is any cognitive mechanism that we use in music specialized for music? The second key concept is when you talk about evolved neural specializations, cognitive abilities that rely on evolved neural specializations also involve learning. And language is a prime example. Babies are not born talking, speaking their native language. They have to learn how to talk. But this learning is neurally predisposed in terms as a form of learning. It's not innate in the sense of present at birth. Darwin articulated this beautifully in The Descent of Man when he said humans have an instinctive tendency to speak, as we see in the babble of our young children, while no child has an instinctive tendency to brew, bake, or write. So he's saying spoken language is based, learning spoken language is based on an innate predisposition to acquire that skill. We don't have an innate predisposition to learn how to make beer or to write or to bake bread, though we can learn those things and enjoy them all. And in this distinction between things that are neurally predisposed and things that are not, the concept of experience expectant plasticity is a key concept versus experience dependent plasticity. The visual word for visual word form area forms through experience dependent plasticity. But the brain of a child learning its native language also has a lot of plasticity as it's learned its native language. But in a sense, the brain is expecting that input. It's experience expectant plasticity. And those two kinds of plasticity have different neural features. But when we look at how babies develop language, like the classical work of Janet Worker, we see how the child develops sound categories of their native language through perceptual narrowing. They're going through a process of experience expectant plasticity for that aspect of language. Okay, so the third concept that's key for this issue is that synthesizing research on development neuroscience and cross-species studies is key. And that we don't need to wait for adaptationist debates to be resolved to determine if we have evolved neural specializations for musicality. Let me give you an example, because that's maybe seem a little non-intuitive. We don't know precisely what the function of music was for our ancestors. How can we know if we have brains that are specialized for it? And actually, those are two separate questions. And here's the analogy. The analogy is bipedal locomotion. Now, there is absolutely 100% universal consensus among biological anthropologists that we are specialized for bipedal locomotion as a species. Evidence is just overwhelming and from a variety of fields, developmental biology, biomechanics, cross-species comparison, the way our skeleton, especially our pelvis, is shaped. There's just no debate about this. Our bodies are specialized for walking upright on two legs as our main form of locomotion. There's zero consensus over the original adaptive value of bipedal locomotion. I mean, there are some theories, and climate change is a leading hypothesis, but no one really knows for sure. And so the point is, you can have strong evidence for biological specialization for an ability without certainty over what the original selective advantage of that ability was. They're really separate issues. They're related, of course, but you can have convincing evidence of biological specialization for something without being sure what that trait was for originally. It's good to have hypotheses and test them, but you don't have to know for sure. And if you remember one thing from this lecture, please remember point four, because I think this is a key point. We can study whether or not we've evolved neural specializations for musicality without being sure which of the different competing hypotheses for why music might have been beneficial to our ancestors is correct. And maybe some of those hypotheses aren't even mutually exclusive. So perhaps there's no single right answer. All right. So how do we tell if a component of musicality relies on evolved neural specializations? Well, we can ask five questions about it. You ask, and I'm going to go through this using the example of recognition of transposed melodies. First, is the ability widespread and spontaneously developing, not reliant on formal training? So you have to look at cross-cultural studies, developmental studies, infant child predispositions. And in the case of recognizing transposed melodies, the answer seems to be yes. It's very widespread, develops spontaneously, kids don't need to be taught it. And so that would qualify as something that perhaps we're specialized for. Is it cognitively neurally complex? Is it not just a simple thing that a brain can sort of do kind of as a byproduct of being a brain, but actually requires a rather sophisticated circuit? And again, here with recognizing transposed melodies, the answer seems to be yes, because of research by people like Robert Satori and others who've shown that when we recognize melodies that are transposed, it doesn't just require the auditory cortex, it's actually a complex network involving connections between the auditory cortex and distant brain regions, including parts of the parietal cortex and other regions. So the brain is working very hard through a complex network to make this effortless percept for us, but it's a complex circuit. Is it present in closely related species that don't engage in musical behavior? And that requires cross-species research. So for example, if there are monkeys that never sing and don't do any kind of musical-like behaviors in the wild in terms of processing elaborate structured auditory sequences, can they recognize transposed melodies? If they can, then that's probably a sign that that's just something that comes for free when you have a primate brain, even if you don't happen to use it in your natural behavioral ecology. Well, as of now, we're not sure, actually. That the study I cite on the slide suggests primates don't recognize transposed melodies. Another study suggests they do, so we need more research. But if they don't, that would be consistent with maybe there's something specialized about human brains for this function. Is it fully explainable via circuits that serve other cognitive functions? And that's a key null hypothesis for musicality, which can be addressed by cross-species studies and by cross-domain research, for example, music language research. So in terms of cross-species studies, if you think being able to recognize transposed melodies is just what happens when you have a brain that does complex auditory processing, that's just a natural byproduct of having a complex brain that does complex sound processing, you can check songbirds. Songbirds do complex learned auditory processing. And it turns out they don't recognize transposed melodies, though they do all kinds of other sophisticated auditory processing and learning. So it doesn't just come for free with a brain that does auditory processing and learns complex auditory processing, or does vocal learning for that matter. And in terms of music language relationships, does this ability, is it essentially a secondary use of circuits that recognize, say, intonation contours in language? So being able to recognize another person's pitch pattern when their voice is higher or lower than yours could be important in speaking a tone language, or and so on. And so you'd really need to look at whether the circuits that process prosody have are the same as the circuits that process musical melody. And so people like Daniela Samler, who've looked very closely at the brain processing of melody and of prosody, I'd love to sit down with her and ask her, you know, what does she think? What are the data that do they suggest that our recognition of transposed melodies in music is simply a secondary use of the same circuits we're using when we recognize intonation contours in speech at different pitch levels? And if it is, then maybe it's not a specialization for music. It's a secondary use of speech circuitry. And finally, if it's a case of something we evolved to do, an ability we evolved to have, is it subject to genetically influenced variation? For it to be something that evolved through mechanisms of biological evolution, there must be some genetic component to it. And therefore, you need to do genomic studies. So those are the five questions you need to ask about any component of musicality to say, is it something potentially that we're evolutionarily specialized for in terms of our brains? And the questions span development, neuroscience, and cross-species research. And if the answers to these questions are yes, so for example, yes, we see something that's widespread and spontaneously developing. Yes, it's cognitively neurally complex. No, it's not present in closely related species. It seems to be something special in our brains. And no, it's not fully explainable as a secondary use of other cognitive functions. And yes, it's subjected to genetic variation. Genetic variation matters and influences the distribution of this trait. That would be consistent with evolutionary neural specialization for that component of musicality. Okay, so what I want to do for the rest of the talk is go through these questions with respect to synchronization to a musical beat. Why that particular aspect of musicality? Because it's one of the very few where we have some information on all of these questions. And as you all know, the beat is an underlying periodicity perceived in complex rhythmic sequences. It often elicits rhythmic, synchronized rhythmic movement. I was hearing about people dancing in Gathertown together. So I guess you're all doing a lot of BPS already in this conference virtually. It's what you tap your foot to in music. And here's just a simple example from the beat alignment test to make it clear for anybody that's not quite clear on what a beat is. You'll hear some music starting and hopefully start to feel a beat very quickly. And then we've superimposed some beeps on top of the beat, aligned with the beat that mark it. And we developed the beat alignment test as a way to actually test beat perception without having people have to tap. We can change the alignment of those beeps and make them on the beat or off the beat in different trials. And people just have to listen and tell you if they think they're on or off the beat. And that's a useful way of measuring their beat perception abilities. Okay, so let's go through these questions for BPS or beat perception and synchronization. So that's perceiving a beat and moving your body in time with it in a synchronized way. Is it widespread and spontaneously developing, not relying on formal training? Yes, so that qualifies as potentially something we're specialized to do. Infants and children are predisposed to move to rhythmically beat-based music. There's some nice work on this from Laura Shirelli and Sandra Triab recently. And reliable synchronization to beat usually develops around school age without relying on formal training. And there's actually an increasing number of studies using motion tracking, mocap technology, with infants and children to study the development of rhythmic movement to music, like this little guy wired up here with various mocap sensors. And so I think we're going to get a lot of information about how this ability develops in the next coming years. Okay, question two, is it cognitively and neurally complex? Yes, actually surprisingly so, given it can involve simple physical movement. So maybe, you know, beat perception and synchronization can just involve bobbing, right? And this doesn't seem like a super complicated behavior from the outside. You're just bobbing your head up and down. But it's hugely complex in terms of what's going on inside. So in terms of cognition, human beat perception is predictive. It's has very broad tempo flexibility. It's modality biased, and there's a strong link to the motor system because dancing to the beat is beat-based music is cross-cultural. It's predictive because when we line up our movements with the beat, the way we do that shows that we're predicting the timing of beat, as in this little image of somebody tapping to a metronome, the simplest form of a beat. Taps align very closely in time with tones. You can't be so closely that they can't possibly be reacting to the tones. They must be predicting them. And the lock-on is very good. If you plot it in a circular polar plot, very close to perfect alignment, typically a little bit ahead of the beat, actually. In terms of modality bias, you can do this exactly the same task with visual flashes with the same timing, but and people can still tap. But when they do, they're much more poorly locked on for these kinds of discretely timed rhythms and show much less kind of accuracy in their synchronization. So that's the modality bias. Metronomes can be going slower or faster, or music can be going slower or faster over a pretty broad tempo range, and people can achieve this highly precise, locked on temporal synchronization with music. Okay, BPS is distinct from pulse-based synchronization seen in some species. So some fireflies flash together, some crickets chirp together in synchrony. And those are fascinating phenomena, but they differ from beat perception and synchronization in some important ways. For example, when we move to beats, it's typically to very rhythmically and melodically complex signals, not metronome-like pulse trains like insects do. We can do it over quite a broad range of tempi. Insects are typically limited to a pretty narrow range. And we often move silently in response to sound. So it's a modality change. We're listening and then moving with our bodies, not for the service of making sound. We can, and sometimes we do, but sometimes we just move silently, whereas the insects are usually doing the same thing as another insect, chirping and so on. All right, in terms of neuroscience, some of the key features are that beat perception strongly engages the motor system. So this is another signal of its complexity. This is even when we're not moving to a beat or intending to move. There's much beautiful work on this now by number of people, including the people I cite in this list here, Jessica Grahn, Virginia Penhune, and so on. Well, why? Why is the motor system all fired up when we perceive beats? Is it a passive consequence of associative learning? So neurons that fire together wire together, and you do tend to move to beats, and so maybe activating beat-based music just activates your motor system. That's one possibility, kind of passive byproduct. Or another view is that maybe does the motor system play a causal role in beat perception, even when you're not moving? For example, in predicting the timing of beats. And several researchers have suggested this, including Dottore, Trainer, Arnal, Morion, and so forth. And myself and John Everson in a paper in 2014, where we proposed the action simulation for auditory prediction, or ASAP hypothesis, with the idea that simulated actions are actually used in premotor areas are used to predict the timing of beats. And John Cannon and I built on this in 2021 in a paper where we kind of try to develop a neurophysiological framework for this hypothesis, building on what was known about motor systems neuroscience. So the beat perception circuit, the proposed circuit according to this hypothesis, is cortical premotor to auditory connections via the parietal cortex. This colored connections here, this auditory dorsal stream connecting posterior superior temporal areas through the parietal cortex to dorsal premotor and supplementary motor areas, motor planning regions. That's how we think this information gets back and forth between the auditory and the motor cortex. And of course, that those key premotor regions in beat perception, like the supplementary motor area, are part of a cortical basal ganglia thalamic loop. And John Cannon and I talk about that in our TICS paper, but Hugo Marchant has talked about it very beautifully in this earlier paper, and Sonia Kotz talks about it. It's very important that this is a loop involving the basal ganglia. So some evidence for this pathway being involved in beat perception, research by Jessica Ross, John Everson, and Ramesh Balasubramaniam showing that TMS of parietal cortex up here near the angular gyrus, far from auditory and motor regions, disrupts beat perception, but not single interval timing. This is actually using the beat alignment test as one of the tests. And so why would zapping something so far from either auditory or motor interfere with beat perception? Well, we think that's because it's an important kind of hub through which the motor system connects to the auditory system. Also, performance on tests of beat perception, in fact, tests of the beat alignment, on the beat alignment test, is correlated with fMRI activity in the angular gyrus, as shown by Jessica Gran and Scheut in this paper. And all of this supports the role of the dorsal stream in beat perception. Okay, so that's a bunch about how complex beat perception is from a neural standpoint. So in other words, it's a complex circuit, suggesting that, again, consistent with perhaps something specialized in our brains. Is BPS present in closely related species that don't engage in musical behavior? Is this something we see in like monkeys that don't do BPS in the wild? You bring them into the lab and they spontaneously start to move to the beat of music, or you can easily train them to do it and so forth. That's not what we see. There are no reports of pet monkeys spontaneously synchronizing movement to an auditory beat, even though monkeys are kept as pets in parts of the world and have been for a long time. And more rigorously, when monkeys are trained to synchronize to a metronome for research purposes, macaques in particular have been trained to do this, spontaneous tendency when they synchronize with metronomes is to react in terms of the way they move, not to predict. So they tap a couple hundred milliseconds after each metronome click, rather than spontaneously predicting, which is what humans do without any special instruction. And monkeys can move predictively in other contexts, like in visuomotor interception, and they can learn to move predictively to metronomic events with special trainings and rewards. That's shown by Hugo Marchant and others. But they don't do it spontaneously. And macaques actually synchronize better to visual than to auditory metronomes. So that's exactly the opposite of what humans do. Now, these kinds of studies have yielded very important neural data on the mechanisms of rhythmic timing. And Hugo Marchant has been a real leader in this domain. And I've drawn on his work. It really informed my Trends in Cognitive Science paper with John Cannon, for example. And I think he's giving the next talk in this conference. So it's really important, groundbreaking work. But no studies have shown that monkeys can synchronize to the beat of complex rhythms, which is a key aspect of BPS. All the work has been with metronomes. In terms of apes that are much more closely related to us, there's a study by Yuko Hattori, a lovely study showing that one chimpanzee showed spontaneous predictive synchronization to a metronome, but did not show any tempo flexibility, so not quite like BPS. And there's a work by Ed Large and Patricia Gray with the bonobo showing that in social drumming with a human, they can do predictive and tempo flexible synchronization, but they're also getting visual cues, not just auditory cues. And that's a concern because non-human primates are better at sync with vision than with auditory. So we don't really know whether they can do it without auditory cues. All right, so that is some stuff about it not coming naturally to animals that seem to be very closely related to us. Again, consistent with the idea that something changed in our brains to make this come easily and naturally to us. The fourth point, is BPS fully explainable via circuits that serve other cognitive functions? And I'm gonna have to spend some time on this because it's the most complex point. And that's the key null hypothesis, right? You could think, okay, it's just recycling circuits that we use for speech, for example. To get at this, we have to do cross-domain studies of music and language and cross-species research. And well, in terms of cross-domain music language stuff, right now, the only thing I can say is that I will say right now is that BPS is not part of ordinary speech. We don't speak to a beat normally in natural conversation. We don't tap our feet and dance to speech under natural circumstances. We can add a beat to speech. Rap does that, but under normal communication, we don't do that. And cross-species research previously led me to argue that BPS was fully explainable via circuits that serve other cognitive functions. And the hypothesis was that BPS circuitry supporting, brain circuitry supporting BPS originated in another behavior that links sound and movement in sophisticated ways. And this is complex vocal learning, learning to produce complex sounds based on auditory experience versus limited vocal learning, which is having innate calls that you can slightly adjust based on your experience, but not learning new sounds based on listening and imitating and having an auditory model of a sound that you're trying to produce. That's complex and different from anything you've done before. And complex vocal learning involves making flexible, precise movements based on what you hear, which is kind of like what we do in BPS. And it relies on brain circuits also implicated in beat perception. So when we look at animals that are specialized for vocal learning, like songbirds, we see brain specializations in premotor, auditory, and basal ganglia regions and their connections that we don't see in animals that aren't vocal learners, like pigeons. And when we look at the brain of a human doing beat processing, we see a lot of activity in premotor, basal ganglia, and auditory regions and their connections. And this kind of similarity in the circuit really intrigued me and made me led me to the vocal learning and rhythmic synchronization hypothesis from 2006, that complex vocal learning is a necessary, if not sufficient, foundation for the capacity for BPS. And it made the prediction that the vast majority of species are incapable of BPS because the vast majority of species are not vocal learners. Most of the animals we're familiar with, our pets, our cats, our dogs, you know, familiar farm animals, horses, they have innate instinctive vocalizations that they don't really learn. They learn how and when to use them perhaps and can modify them in subtle ways, but they're not complex vocal learners. And non-human primates have limited vocal learning. We're the only one with complex vocal learning. So only few groups of mammals have complex vocal learning, the dolphins, the elephants, some bats, and some seals, and three groups of birds, the hummingbirds, the parrots, and the songbirds. So this hypothesis, remember, focuses on human-like BPS versus the kind of pulse-based synchrony we see in insects. So this is synchronization to beats and complex rhythms that's predictive and tempo flexible. And so the hypothesis says that if any other species were capable of this, it would only be a vocal learning species, not a vocal non-learning species. So, and of course, the key thing is we're talking about synchronization without temporal cues from humans, right? So, for example, there's a famous breed of horses, the Lipizzaners, that dance to music, but they always have a rider on board. And of course, they could be getting all of their temporal cues to the beat from the rider through physical touch or sound and so forth. So the if you see one moving to the beat of music, you just don't know if that's the horse or that's the rider. If you show that a horse that can moves to the beat of music predictably and tempo flexibly without getting temporal cues from a human, that would falsify the vocal learning hypothesis because horses are not vocal learners. And we're actually testing that hypothesis right now using a method we developed to test horses for their ability to synchronize to a beat when they're just trotting in circles, not getting cues from a human, but beat-based music is playing in the background. Okay, so evidence supporting the hypothesis come from studies of parrots who show BPS to human music. And so these are birds that are not trained to do this, but by living with humans, they acquire this ability. They do it in these short bursts, or what I call bouts, rather than long sustained episodes. So they'll dance for a little bit and then stop and then dance again. Sometimes they're not on the beat, but they're on the beat often enough that it's clearly not by chance, as we've shown. And this emerges without formal training. And this has been shown in multiple pet parrots by myself and Adina Schachter in two back-to-back papers published in 2009. So I'll just show you a clip from the 2019 study where we actually focused on the diversity of movements the parrot, Snowball, the parrot we study, makes to music. You'll see little labels that indicate the different movements that we annotated in this study where we showed he had 14 different kinds of movements to rhythmic music. And I'll just play a minute of this. If I can, there we go.
Another one bites the dust. Another one bites the dust. And another one down, and another one down. Another one bites the dust. Hey, hey, I'll get to it. Another one bites the dust.
I like this one. This is a good one. Yeah.
I didn't think I'm gonna get along without the way I know.
So you get the idea. It's a synchrony in these little bouts. And, you know, it's such a striking example of convergent evolution or the acquisition of a similar ability by distantly related species. So just to remind you, you know, parrots are birds and they're vocal learning birds, but they're birds as a whole are more closely related to dinosaurs than they are to humans. And so why are we seeing this in this animal that is more closely related to a dinosaur than in primates, than in chimps or monkeys? I think it's because we share a very advanced form of vocal learning with parrots and with very few other animals. There's been a very interesting challenge to the vocal learning hypothesis that's led, one of the things that led me to revise it recently, and that's a study of a sea lion, a beautiful study published by Peter Cook and Andrew Rouse and colleagues, that they showed through operant conditioning, they could teach the sea lion BPS and it could learn to synchronize to beats and it could generalize to new tempi and new music and so forth. And it was an important study because they argued it was a vocal non-learner and therefore a serious challenge to the hypothesis. And I still think there's some open questions because complex vocal learning exists in some pinnipeds. Sea lions are one form of pinniped. Seals are pinnipeds and they have complex vocal learning as shown in this very nice paper in 2019 by Stansberry and Janik. But that aside, the sea lion study led me to rethink the vocal learning hypothesis and really focus on why we see BPS emerging spontaneously in some non-human animals and not others. So no sea lions have ever been shown to acquire BPS spontaneously, which is kind of funny because sea lions are often used in shows, including at marine parks where they quote unquote dance to music with a trainer. And they've been trained to go through a series of movements. And despite hearing this beat-based music twice a day for, you know, multiple months or years and doing these acts, none of them ever spontaneously start to move to the beat. Whereas parrots, without any instruction, just attention from a human and beat-based music, start to do it spontaneously. And dogs, for example, that also are put through all kinds of interesting routines as part of learning to quote-unquote dance to music in a sport called canine freestyling, where they do routines to music with an owner that's dancing to the beat right next to them throughout the training, never seem to move to a beat and acquire that spontaneously. So why parrots? Why not dogs? Why not sea lions? Why are parrots doing it spontaneously and animals much more closely related to us or not? Another reason to rethink the vocal learning hypothesis is increasing evidence that and theorizing that vocal learning is not a binary trait that an animal has or doesn't, but it's a continuum from limited vocal learning to more complex forms of vocal learning to high vocal learning we see in parrots and humans. So last year I published the revised vocal learning hypothesis in a paper in Philosophical Transactions B. And, you know, kind of building on the idea that parrots and humans are the only animals to do spontaneous BPS to music, that is without formal training, and they share unusually complex vocal learning brain systems and abilities. And I won't go into the neural details in this talk, but if you're interested, there's figures in the paper that show the unusually rich vocal learning system of parrots that goes far beyond what we see in songbirds, and the how that has analogies in the speech system of humans and the system we use to learn speech sounds. So this is a very advanced form of vocal learning that I called high vocal learning in the paper that we share with parrots and goes beyond what we see in songbirds. And the hypothesis is that this system provides intrinsic rewards for predicting patterns in sound sequences. The animals with this system are intrinsically motivated to try and predict what's coming next in complex sound sequences. Why would they do that? Well, because those kinds of predictions scaffold the learning of such patterns as part of statistical learning. Statistical learning is not just being a couch potato and letting patterns wash over you. It's actively predicting what's coming next and using those predictions to refine your internal model of the sound sequences. And so when you're a complex vocal learner, it's all about learning complex sound sequences and making predictions is part of that. And when those predictions are about timing of periodic events, the motor system gets involved because it's very good at generating periodic events and therefore internally it can simulate them and thus use that to predict periodic events. And in high vocal learners, those motor areas are strongly connected to auditory areas through two-way connections and traffic can go back and forth very rapidly, which leads you to actually move physically to the beat of music. All right, so this is the revised vocal learning and rhythmic synchronization hypothesis from the paper. And the idea is that high vocal learning is a necessary foundation for spontaneous BPS to rhythmic patterns. So it predicts that there's no case of spontaneous BPS will ever be found in animals that are not high vocal learners. So if somebody shows a horse or a dog or a cat that without any special training, just through growing up with humans and around music, spontaneously moves to a beat in a predictive and tempo flexible way, this hypothesis is dead. That's, you know, it's a very clear prediction. So a key difference between the original vocal learning hypothesis is that In a high vocal learning brain, if it's raised around periodic rhythms, the hypothesis says the animal can develop sporadic VPS, what we see in parrots, like in that video of Snowball. Further neural specialization is needed for sustained VPS, like we see. Like we can be on the beat for minutes at a time, for example, when we dance with each other. And the idea is that this elaboration of the basic ability for spontaneous sporadic BPS evolved via gene culture coevolution, which led to elaboration of auditory motor brain pathways supporting sustained BPS and to circuits motivating sustained BPS. So that would be changes in emotion and reward circuits, for example, in the basal ganglia. There's also an important role for our ape heritage in this story, because vocal learning, apes are not complex vocal learners. So we're apes. So where did our ape heritage play into any of our sense of a beat? Well, I think it was a source of rhythmic vocalization. Parrots move to beats because we provide beat-based sounds in their environment. They don't have those kinds of sounds in nature. Where would we hear beat-based sounds in our ancestral environment or rhythmic periodic sounds? Well, ape vocalizations are a frequent source of auditory rhythms. For example, pant hooting in chimpanzees, high hooting in bonobos, these are often quasi-periodic signals. And these vocalizations often have important social functions, and they show a tendency for temporal coordination. So I'll show you a brief video of chimpanzee pant hooting from my colleague, Dr. Zarin Machanda at Tufts University, who does field work in Uganda and leads a research center there. So they frequently make these kinds of rhythmic vocalizations, and they often start to do it in groups. So presumably our ancestors may have done something similar. So the idea here for the scenario of gene culture coevolution for BPS is that our ancestors had high vocal learning. They were able to imitate complex sounds in sophisticated ways, perhaps even before we had articulate language, kind of what we see in parrots. And they had rhythmic social vocalizations from our ape heritage. And those two together led to sporadic BPS as a fortuitous byproduct, kind of like what we see in parrots today. But then group displays with sporadic BPS became an invention that ancestors hit upon that actually spread culturally because it had some utility. For example, Samuel Mayer and colleagues' idea that maybe this helped advertise the strength of a group to another group and so forth, or the coalition kind of bonding of a group to another group. But then those displays having those useful consequences began to have some unanticipated consequences on cooperation and collective action outside of display context. And that ties into the Pat Savage idea that once you start to move in synchrony with others or to vocalize and move in synchrony with others, maybe it started as a display to, you know, ward off other groups, but doing this started to lead to pro-social effects within your own group. And that had effects outside of musical context for collective action, for example. And those consequences were enhanced when you could sustain the BPS for a bit longer. So not just these short intermittent bouts, but longer sustained periods of synchrony through which you begin to really feel aligned with partners psychologically and emotionally. So this then would in turn have led to selection of genomic variants favoring this kind of sustained BPS, so the capacity for it and the motivation for it. And this would be gene culture coevolution for sustained BPS in humans. Okay, so that's the kind of outline of the idea. And here we've answered 4 out of 5 questions. BPS is widespread and spontaneously developing. It's cognitively neurocomplex. It's not just something that seems to happen in other primate brains that don't engage in musical behavior in the wild. It doesn't seem to be fully explainable as a byproduct of speech and so on. And the final question is it subject to genetically influenced variation? And there you need genomic studies. And there's been a kind of the answer here is yes, because of a landmark study that's under review right now. I hope it will be published soon by Raina Gordon and colleagues. Using genome-wide association studies to study the ability to keep in time with the musical beat. There are twin studies suggesting some genetic influences on rhythmic aptitude, but Raina and her team led this large-scale GWAS on clapping in time with a beat, where they had actually 600,000 genotyped people or something like that answer this question and then be genotyped or use their genotype information to see if there are specific genetic variants that associated with this ability. And then they did an online validation study. I think Nori Jacobi was involved in that, showing that people's answer to that yes, no question does predict their actual abilities. And the bottom line is they found a large number of significant spots on the genome where variants were associated with this ability. And this is a picture of their findings. These are different chromosomes in different colors, and these little letters, which are not visible because they're so small, but these are different points on the chromosome where variants, specific genetic variants, were associated with this ability. And it's key to note that variation in the ability had a 15% heritability, so it was genetically influenced, but very far from genetically determined. So this is not a genetically determined trait. Its environment plays a bigger role. But genetic association with rhythm was enriched in brain areas involved in BPS. In terms of cognition, it was interesting that genetic correlations between BPS and other complex traits were modest. So it wasn't just that it seems to be a byproduct of, say, education. And in terms of evolution, two of the loci they found were what are called human accelerated regions, regions of the genome that have changed extensively since our divergence from our last common ancestor with chimpanzees. That's consistent with gene culture coevolution for BPS. I just have a few slides left and then we're done. I see we're just about at my time, but I'll just finish and then we can have our discussion. So basically, the revised vocal learning and rhythmic synchronization hypothesis makes testable predictions for neuroscience, cross-species studies, and genetics. Please see the paper for those. But just one example, if a genetic prediction predicts genetic relations between BPS and vocal learning, and that was recently tested in a paper that's published by Raina Gordon and colleagues, finding overlap in the genetic signature of beat synchronization and learned song, actually using genomes of human BPS and bird song vocal learning. It also predicts there'll be independent genetic variation for BPS after accounting for genetic relations with vocal learning, not tested yet. It predicts there'll be signatures of natural selection in the genetic substrate of BPS, not tested yet. It also makes some predictions for music language research. So, for example, in terms of the cognitive relations between music and language, the hypothesis argues that the beat-based processing network is an evolutionary elaboration of a dorsal stream network that originally served subserved vocal learning. So these colored lines connect premotor and auditory areas. And of course, the premotor connections to the basal ganglia regions that are so important that I mentioned earlier. So this kind of elaboration or specialization and differentiation of beat processing and vocal learning networks likely increases over the course of individual brain development, I suspect. And so that suggests that there should be stronger relations between beat processing and vocal learning in children than in adults. That's yet to be tested, but I think it aligns nicely with some ideas about music language relations that are outlined in a paper by Rie Asano and colleagues on SciArchive called Moving Beyond Domain Specific versus Domain General Options in Cognitive Neuroscience. And they focus on music language relations in that perspective's paper. It's already been shown that there are interesting and significant links between beat-based processing and phonological processing, so learning the sound structure of language in preschoolers. There's a paper by Woodruff Carr and colleagues. I have a paper with Ola Ozanov-Palchik and Marianne Wolf on that. There's also work with adults on these links between beat processing and phonological processing, but direct adult-children comparisons in terms of how strong those links are remains to be done. And the hypothesis would predict that be stronger in children than in adults because the specialization, elaboration of differentiation of these circuits would grow through development, be more overlapping early in development. Okay, so just to conclude then, is music part of our evolved human nature? Well, new lines of evidence are emerging, and I actually think we can answer this question about human nature in the coming few decades and settle this old debate that goes back to Darwin and William James because of the explosion of research, including by many people in this conference. And determining if we've evolved neural specializations for musicality is going to require synthesizing research from a number of disciplines. Neuroscience alone is not going to do it. We're going to need research on development, cross-species studies, neuroscience, of course. Cross-cultural work is going to be very important. And studying multiple components of musicality, so not just BPS. And it'll be important to relate the findings in these studies of evolved specializations to adaptationist theories, but we don't have to wait for the resolution of those debates about adaptation to be able to firmly answer whether or not we've evolved neural specializations for music processing. And then stepping back to the larger significance for human evolutionary biology, music may be a powerful system for studying cognitive gene culture coevolution. In fact, it might be the first domain where we find convincing evidence of this process in shaping the human mind, which would be very exciting. And of course, even if music is a purely cultural invention, which it may well be, this is a young research area, cross-species research of doing this kind of work on musicality will inevitably reveal new insights into animal cognition and what's distinct about the human mind. So I just want to end by dedicating this talk to Ed Wilson, who's my PhD advisor, and reading his book, Promethean Fire, as an undergraduate in 1983, helped propel my interest in how gene culture coevolution shaped the human mind. So with that, just a couple of readings related to this talk. And I want to thank you, colleagues and funders, and thank you all very much for your attention.
Thanks so much for this incredibly comprehensive and, again, very thought-provoking presentation, Ani. We probably have a few questions, even though we are really tight for time, I have to say. So if you would be okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
I would say we move on and give Hugo the floor. But okay. If the questions come in, I would really, really super appreciate you answering them.
Of course.
And the one question that I want to leave you is,
yes.
No beat perception without motor behavior?
Wait, but is that a question?
Can you ever think about the beat, perceiving a beat, without thinking about motor engagement?
Without thinking consciously about motor engagement?
No. Does it always have to lead to motor reactions?
Actually, overt movements, you mean?
Yes. But I'm making a mess here, so okay. I should be clear about my question. I'll come back to you about this.
Please do, because really I'd like to understand what you're
Thanks again, Ani. I really, right. really appreciate